Hello and welcome to White Wall Wednesday, where we break down image making into simple, really easy to understand terms. My name is Brooke Shaden, I'm a fine art photographer, and I'm going to show you through my process today from start to finish. So we're going to get over here and start a sketch. Image making can seem really complicated, especially when there are a lot of layers to it, where maybe you're using Photoshop or there are a lot of props or you're sort of creating a set where there wasn't one before. But it doesn't have to be that complicated, and I'm going to show you just how uncomplicated it can be with this sketch that I'm going to make. I keep my ideas really simple, and I actually think that a hallmark of, for me, what makes an image impactful is if you can easily sort of let your eye go to all the different elements in the frame and not be distracted by unnecessary details. So I like to keep my images quite simple. I like to use a center frame where there's a square frame and a person right in the center of the image. That way your eye is naturally drawn to the character and then you can start to explore what else there is in the image. I'm going to create an image that seems really simple, but it's actually quite technically challenging. So I've got my square paper here. I'm going to draw right on this as my frame, and I know that I want to be in the center of the frame, but in the bottom portion of the frame. That's what I'm envisioning for this image, because I'm going to do an image where there's this big white wall and my hair is just growing all over the wall. So I know that I need to put myself sort of tinier down to the bottom of the frame. And I'm going to have hair just doing this, like literally growing all over the place, facing the wall. Once I've got a sense of exactly what I want my frame to look like in terms of the composition, the angle of the camera, things like that, I start to think about all of the little details and I write a list or even a paragraph about it. So I'll write things like, well, what height should my tripod be? What lens would be best? What do I need to do to avoid those common pitfalls that won't allow me to edit properly? But then beyond that, what color should my dress be? What color should I edit into? All these fun visual details that make an image truly yours. Granted, you do not have to plan out an image. That does not make or break your imagery or your pictures or your art, but what it does do is give you, the creator, full control, and you've sort of thought through a lot of the common things that people have to think about in their art, but you've done it ahead of time so you can be really sure that you're doing it the way that you like it to be. I'm just writing down things like subject in the lower third of the frame, hair like snakes. I haven't decided on a color palette. I'm gonna say either neutral or light blue. Camera level with subject. I don't wanna make the subject look super tall or really tiny. I just wanna be right level with them. A note for myself: shoot the hair more times than I think. I always mess that up. I always shoot under instead of over. Not a common photographer problem, but I do that. I like to make lighting notes, so I'm gonna mention that the light should be straight on to the subject. I've talked in White Wall Wednesday videos before about how I really like window light to come from the side, because that way you're creating shadows, it looks a little bit more dynamic, you can avoid really flat looking images that way pretty easily. But for this particular image, I want the light to hit from the front for two reasons. One is that I actually want this to be quite a flat looking image. I think that's going to be interesting for this particular picture. I hope it's clear by now, but I don't really care about what you're supposed to do in an image. I think that, you know, photo schools and stuff like that would probably say, never make your images look flat, but I actually really like it for certain images, especially if it gives a painterly feeling. The other reason is a technical reason. If you are editing a whole bunch of hair up into the image all over the place, like we're gonna do. So essentially we're going to take my hair and photograph it up this way, up that way, all over the place. And when we're photographing my hair, if there are weird shadows on different pieces, then I won't be able to use those pieces in a different part of the image. It has to go wherever that shadow naturally was. So for example, if I shoot my hair like this, and there's a certain shadow on it, maybe coming from one side, then I can't move that hair to the other side as easily. So it gives me less opportunity to have more latitude in Photoshop, and I really, really want that because I want this to work. I also do a lot of writing conceptually about my images. So once I've got sort of the technical stuff down, I like to write about what the image means to me. So I might write something like, if I can read this scribble, it says, "A girl stands against a giant wall looking small and fragile. Her hair explodes from her head, almost recalling Medusa in its intensity and snake-like tentacles. She looks small and weak, but this contrast shows that she isn't. The thing people hide behind becomes a symbol of power, the hair." That's sort of the gist of this image. It's going to be an image that is quite simple in its design. The visuals will look very simple, very flowing, hopefully very natural, of a person and their hair and a white wall. Really, really simple, but it's really not that simple. It's quite difficult to edit things like hair all together because it's all of these fine details that make editing quite challenging. If you have to cut around the hairs, if the color shifts while you're shooting, if the light shifts, things like that, it can be really challenging, but we're going to have a lot of fun and we're going to get it done. I've created images like this in the past with my hair moving and things like that, working with white walls and working with myself. And that's how I know what to avoid. So much of photography in any art form is about doing it over and over and over again until you learn what doesn't work. So I go into a photo shoot not only thinking about what will be challenging during the shoot, but also what will make editing really difficult. And that's why I think so much about things like, well, how is the light pointing at me? And will that be a challenge? What about the camera angle? What about the background? So some things that I already know will be a struggle in Photoshop is the color of the wall. It's a little bit light compared to my skin, and I prefer my backgrounds to be darker. So that's one thing that I know might be a bit of a challenge in Photoshop, is darkening the walls, but keeping my skin, my dress, my hair a lighter color than the wall. Another challenge is just blending my hair together. Where will it blend? How do you know if it's going to work? And the answer is just to shoot a lot of images in this case. So I'm going to take a ton of pictures of my hair, basically just doing this, slapping it against the wall so that it looks like it's actually touching, which brings me to problem number three, which is that I have tried images like this with just hair that I had as stock images. Like maybe I'm out in a field and I've got my hair flipping all over the place, and I've used images like that of my hair to try to edit onto a wall, but you can tell when something is climbing up a wall. So if I just do that, it looks different than if I hit the wall, because you can see it stick for just a fraction of a second, but that's all you need in photography, is that fraction of a second. These are all such weirdly specific things, and that's why you can't teach this in a photo class, because it's not going to be relevant to everybody. But if you're thinking to yourself, this isn't relevant to me, but I get it, know this. It takes so much practice to figure out those nuances, and the things that you need to know for your craft are going to be different than the things I need to know for mine. So get out there and do it again and again and again, and try and fail, and then figure out what went wrong. That's the really key step, is analyzing why didn't this work and how can I fix it next time, and then your process will go super smooth in the future. I've decided on this dress because it has some color, it has a good shape, and it's going to show some skin in the back when I go to the wall to pose. Before I officially start shooting and flipping my hair all over the place, what I actually want to do is put my hair up in a bun on my head. That way I can get a really clean shot of my neck and back without any hair dripping down. And then I can start to, in Photoshop, build the other hair that I will photograph flying through the air onto that picture, instead of trying to pose while flipping my hair at the same time. I've got my camera set up, I'm ready to shoot, I've got my remote, my hair is up, I just have to choose a pose and then shoot a few pictures. I know that right now my shutter speed isn't fast enough, it's at 80, and I need it to be like well over 200. I would say 250 because I'm going to be doing all these hair flips and I want to make sure that my hair doesn't have any motion blur on it. So that means that I want to take my ISO up from what it was. I'm going to go to like, I think 1250 is okay. I'm not afraid of ISO. So that looks good to me. And we can do a test shot. Quick and simple. Okay, so my camera's angled down too much. I can see that, but at least we can zoom in. It's in focus. My hair looks good from what I can see. I can see a little bit of motion blur. That's not good. So we'll just make some quick adjustments. Point up a little bit. Perfect. I think that's the pose that I'm going to go with, and it looks really good, so I don't actually need to do anything else. I'm just going to use that one image. I'm jumping into Photoshop now and I'm sorting through my images in Bridge. I'm choosing the ones that I want. For example, I'm marking my main shot as the one that I will build off of, and that's really important that I do that first. So I'm marking that one, and then I'm going to go through and figure out if there's any hair shots that just didn't work. I can remove those. But in general, I'm just gonna start opening one by one a hair shot and then layering it into my image. This is going to be a lot of copy and paste and blend and then start over to composite this image together. I shot these images on a Sony a7 R3 with a 24-70mm lens, and I am editing on this Microsoft Surface Studio computer. That means that I can edit directly on the screen, so that's what I'm going to do, is edit with my hand right on the screen so that I can get really fine details edited, like cutting around hair and things like that, with a little bit more ease. I always wear this wrist pad, and I do that so that my wrist doesn't get hurt when I'm constantly on my wrist, on the mouse or on the screen. So I always have a wrist pad on too. I like to take the exposure up a little bit if I've underexposed, which I definitely have for this image. So I'm just taking the exposure up slightly. But I'm really aware that that's making the wall brighter too, so I might try a couple different things, like just taking the shadows up and see if that helps. It gives me a little bit more latitude at least, especially in the dress area. That's better. Pulling the blacks up is actually really a lot more helpful because then the whites, like in the wall, aren't being affected. So I think that looks really good. Let's open that image up. Just assessing if anything needs to happen before we start layering our images on, and I think that we're good to go. So the first thing that I like to do is to expand my frame. I like to make sure that we're working with a nice big complete frame, and I might crop it later. I might decide that something is wrong, but for right now, I'm going to make it bigger. I'm doing that by selecting a color in the background and then making sure that color is on the bottom of my color swatches. And then with the crop tool, just expanding outward. And that way we've got sort of a closer color to what I actually want in the background. Now it's not exact and the frame's a little bit weird, but I'm just gonna create a new layer and start to paint in the background. I don't mind that I've gotten rid of pretty much all the texture here because I'm going to add it back in later. So right now I'm just looking to make sure that my frame is nice and big and I'm generally where I want to be in the shot. Now let's make the background of the original image match what we just painted in. Start building the hair up. And I'm just gonna check through a lot of the hair shots and just see, like for example, that one has too much motion blur. I probably don't want to use that. But they sort of got better as I went, so I want to keep that in mind. Like that one's really good because of how it sits here with the hair. And that one, so yeah, they're definitely getting better. Especially at the end, I did some burst shots and that allowed me to get some really good images like that. You see how the hair is falling in progression? And that's because I set my camera to 5 burst shots in a row. Good. So that's gonna sort of be where the golden shots are. So I wanna make sure that I have enough of them, which hopefully I do. And I want to also see different angles. So if I can find a shot where my hair is going straight up the back of my neck, like from directly behind, that would really be ideal for the very first shot that I'm going to build on. Nearly. So some these are much better. Like that. That one, that one, that one, that one. Those are all really good for that. Even that one, but that doesn't quite have the lift that I want it to have. Yeah, all of these are good. I think I'll go with that one. Now I have to keep in mind that I did take the black point up quite a lot, so I'm going to do that for the hair shots as well. I'm just selecting really roughly around the hair and pasting it in. And that's how we're gonna start.
Thank you for watching this very in-depth White Wall Wednesday, and I really hope that it inspires you in some way to get out there and create. That's all that I want to do, is to inspire other people to make whatever is in your heart and whatever you think is worthy of putting out there into the world. As always, subscribe if you would like to, share this with friends if you can. I'd really appreciate it, and that really helps me to keep making videos. Thanks so much.